will praise. Yes, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. To find again, I know a safe place you can hide, where only love and peace will abide.
I want to come into your spirit, it feels good.
Don't it feel good?
Lift your head, clap your hands, and feel joy. Leap for it.
Leap for joy.
Come on, everybody, feel the spirit, it feels good.
Oh, yes, it feels good.
It's your strength. Go ahead, dance and jump in.
Don't be a stranger, you can live there all the time. In order to get there, you don't have to travel far. Just pray without ceasing, and it will come where you are. Don't it feel good?
Lift your head, clap your hands, and feel joy, leap for it.
Go ahead and leap for it.
Come on, everybody, feel the spirit, it feels good.
Oh, yes, it feels good.
Use your strength, go ahead and dance and jump.
You are in for a treat. This whole service, these guys are rocking. Hoofda. So thank you all for joining us today, and also to those that are live streaming, we welcome you too. We have some announcements today. I'd like to call your attention to your insert. Well, from today through next Sunday, Easter Sunday, including today at 1:30, Carol Jean Meyer will be facilitating a group Having Fun with Forgiveness. Now check it out, because this is just steady all week long. On Tuesday, April 11th, Lynn Jensen will be facilitating a class called Personal Resilience. This is going to be an awesome class. Also, check that one out. Wednesday, don't forget, the Silent Unity Noontime Meditation goes on every Wednesday at noon, so. And we honor those that are having a birthday or anniversary for the following week. And then Maundy Thursday, oh my gosh, that'll be great. And then Friday, nonetheless, Good Friday, it's going to be powerful. And then Saturday, hang on to your hats, is the extravaganza. Woohoo! I am so excited. Get your grandbabies, everybody in the world, bring them in. So, okay, you can see what my favorite part is. We are very excited about a very new way to stay connected with Unity Minneapolis via texting. All you need to do is text Unity Minneapolis to 313131, and you will receive text to keep you informed about what's going on here. And check your bulletin, because it'll give you step-by-step directions on how to do it. So for signing up, so thank you. So check your insert for other information, like this choir has got a concert coming up, oh my gosh. Ellen Davenport coming to Unity Minneapolis. Many other classes and events going on here at Unity Minneapolis. So if you have any specific questions, check your bulletin, the Garden Court, Peak of the Week, or our website. So if you have a cell phone or electronic device, before you silence them, check in on Facebook if you feel called to do so, and let them know where you are today, this morning. And let others know that wherever they are in their spiritual journey, they are welcome here too. So thank you. So let's begin our service with prayer. Well, let's just take in a breath. Oh, sweet Spirit, we thank you for this day, for this congregation, for everything it does, volunteers, congregation, staff, every single thing, for all the good we do. We thank you for this day, for our leaders, for every single person that comes in our path. We give thanks, and so it is, and so we let it be. Amen. So, how about a beautiful Palm Sunday, huh? So we begin our service by affirming together our core values, vision, and mission statement found in your bulletin. So let's start with our core values together. We are loving, transforming, welcoming, spirit-filled, prosperous, and joyful. And our vision, centered in spirit, we celebrate a world transformed by love, peace, and compassion. And our mission statement, we are a vibrant, inclusive, prosperous spiritual community, inspiring and empowering full expression of the divine within through prayer, education, and service. And I invite our on-duty prayer chaplains to please stand. These individuals arrived early today to hold sacred space for all of us, and they're here to support you in prayer for any celebrations, joys, or concerns you'd like to pray about. They will listen with the ears of their heart and hold it in the strictest of confidence. So please, if you have a prayer desire, check one of them out. I assure you it'll be a blessing for them as well as for you. So let's stand for our opening song, Brand New Day. Put your hat on.
Everybody look around, cause there's a reason to rejoice, you see. Everybody come out, and let's commence to singing joyfully. Everybody look up, and feel the hope that we've been waiting for. Everybody be glad, because a sign of fear and dread has gone. Freedom, you see, has got our hearts singing so joyfully. Just look about, you owe it to yourself to check it out. Why can't you feel a brand new day? 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 Everybody be glad, because the sun is shining just for us. Everybody wake up to the morning into happiness. happiness. Hello world, it's like a different way of living now. Thank you world, we always knew that we'd be free somehow. In harmony, show the world that we've got liberty. It's such a change for us to live so independently. Freedom, you see, it's got our hearts singing so joyfully. Just look above, you know it to yourself to check it out. Can't you feel a brand new day?
Good morning, good morning. I can assure you there's not another church in Minneapolis that sang that as an opening song this morning. I can assure you of that. Well, good morning and welcome, and we certainly welcome those that are live streaming with us today as well. We're just really glad you're here today. It's Friendship Sunday, right? Yeah. Let's appreciate all these friends in our life, okay? Unity is that open and welcoming, inclusive community. Therefore, one of our favorite things to do here each and every Sunday morning is to acknowledge our guests, our friends. So today, if you're with us for the first, second, or third time, we invite you to allow us to honor your presence here. I promise we'll do nothing drastic. Take your courage in your hand, calling all courage. Take your courage in your hand and raise your hand as I raise my hand. Courage, courage out there. Keep your hands up, please. Keep your hands up, please. Keep your hands up, please, until our ushers get to you. Keep your hands up, please, until our ushers get to you. That packet of information you're receiving tells you a lot about Unity Minneapolis. There's a welcoming CD in there. There's a pink card. If you choose to fill out any part of that card, turn that into our book desk. We have a special gift for you. The rose is a gift from our congregation so that we can easily recognize you and give you a very personal welcome. All of that's important, and yet one of the most important things that's said on this platform each and every Sunday morning is this, and that is, my dear friends, wherever you are on your spiritual journey, wherever that may be, you're welcome here. We welcome you, we bless you, we behold the living presence of the divine within you. And again, we welcome our guests today streaming for the first time. We're grateful they're with us as well. Let's appreciate these marvelous guests, okay? Whoa. And of course, we enjoy greeting each other. We do it with a handshake, a hug, a smile, namaste. We ask before we hug. Let's do that right now, okay? So we just recently finished a membership class, and we are truly blessed this morning. We'll be receiving 17 new members into our church this morning. So Reverend Jeanette and Reverend Patty, they assisted in that membership class. I should say I probably assisted them in the membership class, but they're going to assist me with this installation service.
Praise God.
So as we call each name, we invite our new members to come join us up on the platform. Be it resolved that the following new members be accepted into Unity Minneapolis as of April 9th, 2017. Steve Brumbaugh, Jonathan Carpentier, Michelle Chartier, Cheryl Cota, Nia Delaval, David Fultz, Julie Gann, Audrey Gillen, Diana Grandy, Jeremy Grazzini, Lynn Keat, Marge Keith, Michael Kling, John Landstrom, Stevie Peterson, Robert Ward, and Myrna Waterman.
Charles Fillmore, co-founder of Unity, defined Unity in this way: Unity is a link in the great educational movement inaugurated by Jesus, our wayshower. Our objective is to discern the truth in Christianity and prove it. The truth we teach is not new. Neither do we claim special revelations or discovery of new religious principles. Our purpose is to help and teach humanity to use and prove the eternal truth taught by our master teacher.
You have expressed a desire to officially affiliate yourself with Unity Minneapolis and, in doing so, the greater Unity movement, so that together we might make Charles Fillmore's definition of unity come alive by modeling for humankind the truth that Jesus taught, the truth that Jesus demonstrated. You are familiar with and you are in alignment with the vision and mission that our congregation has created. Do you, as new members, commit to supporting Unity Minneapolis' vision and mission statements with your thoughts and your prayers and your service? If so, please say, I do. Mr. Vice President, these individuals have expressed a desire to unite in membership with Unity Minneapolis. They have fulfilled the requirements for membership as outlined by our bylaws. They have also pledged their alignment with our vision and mission statements. They are demonstrating their commitment to their own spiritual growth, and they have promised to support this church. Do you, as the elected representative of the congregation, accept these individuals as members of, with all of privileges as members in membership?
We do.
From this day forward, let it be known that these individuals have become members of Unity Minneapolis here in Golden Valley. Will the congregation please rise and sing? The words are in your bulletin. I behold the Christ in you.
I can see that perfect one.
Let's welcome the newest kids on the block, okay? You may be seated.
We now move deeper into spirit with the reading of the daily word and the singing of Surely the Presence. As the usher brings down the prayer box, you're invited to mentally add your prayers to the box. Your prayers are then prayed with by our prayer ministry for 7 days, and then they're forwarded to Silent Unity, where they're prayed with for an additional 30 days. The word for today is hope. I am filled with hope. Jesus came to Jerusalem as a hero after many healings and bringing Lazarus back to life. Those who saw him were filled with hope and laid down their cloaks and palm leaves to honor him. He continued to demonstrate humility and the willingness to serve. I have sometimes been willful, wanting to have things my way, unbending. I have discovered, though, that my highest and best is not served by insistence, but rather by opening to the will of God in all ways. I continually learn the power of non-resistance. Jesus' story is one of overcoming. As I move through my life humbly, being of service to others, I pray that my life is one of overcoming too. I trust that I will continually be led and guided, and I'm filled with hope. And the scriptures tell us, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. Matthew 20:28. The word for today is hope.
Take a moment and relax. Relax in that sweet presence we know is spirit. Breathe in that presence, some gentle, deep breaths. Few things in this physical realm seem like they can be counted on. But one thing you can always count on is spirit, spirit within. Difficult times come and go, but Romans 8:37 tells us, no matter what the issue is, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ, who loves us. For this we give thanks. For God is with us now and always. Psalm 143, verse 10 says, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me. In all things, God leads us whenever we ask. But we must ask. So let us relax and concentrate on the goodness of God within and rest in the peace that passes understanding. And so we relax in our truth. And now, as we return to this space and time, open your eyes when you are ready, and let us remember God's goodness and love lasts forever. And so it is, and so we let it be. Amen.
Brought me this far to leave me.
No!
brought me this far to leave me.
So this morning, I was in the church, obviously, early on Sunday mornings, I normally do, and I ran into someone that I had not seen in a couple of weeks, and of course, the first thing we did was hugged, you know, really. And then the next thing that happened was, it was Libby Sheely that I ran into. We were standing in the bookstore, and then the next thing that happened, of course, was she started to straighten my tie and pull a little string out from over here, and I go, it takes a whole church to dress the minister, you know? And so I really appreciated that. But then we got into a conversation about time, and we were talking about how busy life can be sometimes. And we got into this conversation about a book that we had just finished called The Big Leap. And The Big Leap talks about, first of all, if you want more time in your life, stop talking that you don't have enough time. What a concept, Reverend Pat. Stop talking about that. Stop talking about how busy you are if you want to be less busy. These are just spiritual laws that we teach here. So we both agreed that we wanted to do a better job of that. And so Libby continued to talk, and we shared our life a little bit. And suddenly I paused, and I said, Libby, I'm really feeling your father today. I don't know Libby's father. Never met that I'm aware of, Libby's father. And I said, I'm really feeling your father today. She said, Reverend Pat, today is my father's birthday. Would have been my father's birthday. Now, I was feeling her father, I think, also, not necessarily because of the birthday, but because her father was a minister as well. And ministers have this special thing for other ministers. Do you know what I'm talking about? And so we kind of discussed about what it was like for her to grow up in that home as her father is a minister. And I wondered, you know, as I wondered about, you know, Palm Sunday. You know, it's not like this is the first time we've ever had a Palm Sunday, you know. It's not the first time. And sometimes ministers go through this thing like, oh, my goodness, what am I going to say on Palm Sunday that I haven't said before? And then suddenly I realized that whatever I say in Palm Sunday will be perfect for me because I'm in a different place in consciousness. And whatever you hear today about Palm Sunday will be the right and perfect thing for you to hear today because you are in a different place in consciousness. Or as my good friend Reverend Duke used to say, tell it again. Half of them wasn't there. The other half was asleep. The other half didn't hear what you said. Tell it again. And yet, you know, as we get into some of our classic stories, as we enter into this Holy Week, some of the most sacred time in Christianity, you know, we get into this time and thinking, oh my goodness, what can I do differently, say differently? And I know that what is said this morning will be the right and perfect thing. The song, Can't Give Up Now. Did you love it? Did you love it? Absolutely. Yes. You know, I think, first of all, I think that as Jesus, he could have been singing that song going into Jerusalem. He could have literally have been singing that song. Jesus just didn't get to Jerusalem by a whim of his, well, I think I'll go to Jerusalem and have a vacation. That was not his purpose there. You know, if we remember, of Jesus' ministry is normally divided into three different areas. The first area of Jesus' ministry was when Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, and he was baptized, and his scripture says that there was a voice from heaven that came forth and said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And Jesus started his ministry after his baptism, and he stayed in the Jerusalem area. But things were not going quite as well as Jesus wanted it to go in Jerusalem in that first year, so he decided to leave. Now, some theologians believe that Jesus left Jerusalem during that time because he was still in the shadow of John the Baptist, and Jesus was very clear that he could not put new wine into old wineskins. Jesus' teachings were somewhat different. Jesus' teachings was the kingdom of God is within, and the kingdom of God is here, and the kingdom of God is now, and this kingdom of God is love. And so Jesus was not getting the response that he wanted, so to speak, so he decided to go to Galilee. And in Galilee, of course, he preached primarily to peasants, those people that till the land, those people that was in servitude to a wealthier class of people. And so he constantly taught. He says, you know, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. And he told parable after parable about what the kingdom of God was about. And he used simple examples. But suddenly again, Jesus felt that he was not getting the results that he wanted. And so a turning point in Jesus' ministry, we are told, was in Caesarea Philippi. He was in this location, and he asked the question to his disciples. He says, now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, and still others say one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And one disciple, Peter says, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Now, here are the disciples that he's hung around with for a few months. And they still, my dear friend, did not acknowledge him as the Messiah, did not immediately say, "You are the Messiah." And of course, Peter did. And Peter representing faith. And all of a sudden, Jesus stopped and he says, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven." My Father in heaven. And so Jesus realized, even at that point, that needless to say, he was not getting the impact. If his own people, his own disciples, did not necessarily immediately say, "Thou art the Messiah, the Son of the living God," Jesus knew that there was something else for him to do. He needed a new strategic plan. And Jesus immediately, Luke says, at once, Jesus felt that he needed to go back to Jerusalem. He needed to go back to Jerusalem. Luke even says that he set his face to Jerusalem. He made a decision, an important decision in his ministry. And he started back to Jerusalem. Within the next 3 days, he also experienced something called the Transfiguration on the top of a mountain. Remember, Jesus went to the top of the mountain. He separated himself from the rest of his disciples. He did take John and Peter and James, love and wisdom and faith, with him to the top of the mountain. And there on the mountaintop, he had quite an experience, and so did Peter and John and James. They saw Moses representing the law. They saw Elijah representing the prophets. And suddenly, each one had built a tabernacle. And suddenly, it says that Jesus was aglow. And a voice came from heaven. Jesus didn't say this, but a voice came from heaven and said again, "This is my Son in whom I'm well pleased." Jesus was looking for validation for the decision that he had made to go back to Jerusalem. Have you ever wanted validation for a decision that you've made? You know without a doubt that Spirit put it on your heart, and yet there's something within us. In our humanness, we want validation. And so Peter says, "Wow, you're the Son of God. Let's stay here, faith. Let's stay here on the mountaintop. Let's stay on the mountaintop. In fact, we can build you a tabernacle here as well. Wow, how many of us, my dear friends, have constantly wanted to stay on the mountaintop? Yes, we do. We experience that in our morning meditation quite often, do we not? We experience that, and there's a part of us that says, oh, just let me stay here. And yet we know there's another part of us to go out in the world, being that presence of the divine. And Jesus said to them, no, we must go down off the mountain. And as Jesus went to the bottom of the mountain, there his disciples were attempting to heal a demented boy. And they had not succeeded. And of course, Jesus came and he has succeeded. And one of the disciples came to Jesus and said, well, why did you succeed? Don't you love that? And Jesus didn't say, because I am the Christ, I succeeded. Jesus says, what you need, my friends, is prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting. Now, metaphysically, for unity, we would say prayer. Prayer is affirmative prayer. Prayer is affirmation. Fasting is denial. In that what we use when we're experiencing a less than wholeness appearance in our life, we use the power of affirmative prayer, and we use the power of denial. Denying that illness, whatever it looks like, has any power over us. For we know that in truth, we are whole and we are well and we are free. So Jesus, of course, had his face toward Jerusalem, and nothing would keep Jesus from going towards Jerusalem. Absolutely nothing. Ernest Wilson, in a book called The Week That Changed the World, says that there are several reasons why Jesus was crucified. He says, first of all, he cast out evil spirits from an afflicted man. He dined with the Pharisees without conforming to the custom of washing before the meal. He set aside the restrictions of what a Jew might eat. He healed a sick woman on the Sabbath. And finally, he raised Lazarus from the dead. This was the miracle that sealed his fate as far as the Jewish authorities were concerned. I would add one other thing to that list, Ernest. I would add one other thing to that list, and that is the forgiveness. He preached forgiveness, that we had the power within us to do our forgiveness work. Do you see, at that time, in order for these peasants, in order for them to be forgiven, they had to go to the temple in Jerusalem. They had to go to the temple there. And it was only there that their sins could be forgiven. They could be washed white as snow. Of course, there was a charge for that, being washed white as snow. And yet, you see, Jesus came along and says, you don't have to go there. You can do your own forgiveness work. So Jesus was very clear. And you can imagine the crowds that as Jesus went into Jerusalem, you can imagine the crowds that had gathered. If you had just heard that someone had raised someone from the dead, I think you might be there too. You wanted to see what this was about. And so Jesus enters Jerusalem, and the scripture I've chosen today is from Mark. Mark was the first gospel written. It was the closest time to Jesus' life. It says, and when they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter, you will have found tied there a coat that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it to me. If anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Just say this, the Lord needs and will send it back here immediately. And they went away and found a coat tied near a door outside in the street. And as they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, what are you doing untying the colt? And they told them that what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. And then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it, and many people spread their cloaks on the ground, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. And then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David." When David reigned, the kingdom was prosperous. It was peaceful. He was one of the most fabulous rulers in Israel. And they were still remembering that. Blessed is the coming of ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. And then he entered Jerusalem, went into the temple, and when he had looked around at everything as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. It's recorded in all the Gospels. So if you read all the Gospels, you will fill in and color some additional details. But obviously, you know, Jesus planned this trip into Jerusalem. Jesus had walked everywhere he had ever been. Jesus had never ridden a donkey. But this was the first for Jesus. So why did Jesus go to all this trouble to do this pictorial presentation? Because that was it. It was almost as if he was planning a play, almost planning a staging of what he was going to do as he entered into Jerusalem. Why? Because hundreds of years prior to Jesus, there was a prophet, Zechariah. Zechariah, at the time of Zechariah, there was also experiencing trouble at home, trouble in the kingdom. And this is what Zechariah wrote. Jesus knew the scriptures. Jesus knew the Old Testament. He knew what had been written. And this is what Zechariah had written. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion." Zion is another name for Jerusalem. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you triumphant and victorious is he, humble, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the fold of a donkey. He will cut off the chariots from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem. And the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth." These peasants that were under strict Roman rule, not only Roman rule, but these peasants also had strict rules that they had to follow because of the temple. They wanted peace in their life. And it was Jesus who had taught all along and finally says, "Let me show you, let me demonstrate this. Let me demonstrate it." And he showed the picture coming in on a coat. Scripture also tells us that he went ahead into Jerusalem. Of course, one of the things that Jesus was hoping to accomplish was that not only the realization of the Messiah, of him being the Messiah, but he also wanted for the authorities, the religious authorities, that's often referred to as the scribes and the Pharisees, he wanted them to acknowledge that as well. So he went in to Jerusalem, no acknowledgement. No acknowledgement. They had gone right about their own business. In some ways, the intention that Jesus had set in his heart of hearts could have been called a failure, because he didn't get what he had intended for in this processional, this Hosea to the highest. So Palm Sunday, you know, what can we learn from Palm Sunday in our own life? I think there's several things for me to be reminded of. It's just not Palm Sunday. What I can learn is it started way before Palm Sunday. It started when Jesus made that important decision in his life that he was going back to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is another name for the holy city, the prince, the peace, city of peace. So Jesus made that decision to go back. How often are we called to make a decision in our life? We make a decision to follow our own indwelling Spirit of God. And that's not always an easy decision. Just as Jesus made that decision to go to that city of peace, he experienced the highs, the mountaintop experiences, and he experienced the low in his life as well. And when we make that decision to follow our own indwelling Christ, to follow that purpose that we have, that intention in our life that we have, we too will have the lows and the highs in our own life. But just like Jesus, he did not turn back. And we are called not to turn back when things get tough. Can't turn back now? Can't quit now? Yes, Jesus could have. He could have in a heartbeat, but he chose not to. He gave us the example of continuing to recommit to the purpose, the intention that we have in our life. Our new members this morning, God bless you. As you begin your journey here in Unity Minneapolis, you've made the commitment to your own spiritual growth, and you've chosen to do that through this community. You will experience some highs and some lows, but know that throughout that whole process, that divine spirit of God is within you. No need to give up now. I believe the second thing that I can learn from Jerusalem, from that Palm Sunday, was that Jesus rode the donkey. You know, the donkey stands literally. The donkey had not been trained, and Jesus got on that donkey. I don't believe that he had ever ridden a donkey, and yet, guess what happened? It was calm and serene. To quote one of my ministerial friends, Jesus rode the donkey. The donkey did not ride Jesus. And that's what we're called to do. We are called to bring in some of our asinine behavior. Donkey is sometimes referred to as an ass. You know, some of our own asinine behavior. I could name you several of mine, okay? But I won't, okay? But we are called to allow those habits, those things that do not serve us well, those behaviors, we are called to put them under the direction of the Christ, by whatever name you call it, under the direction of the divine. And only when we surrender, we allow that Spirit of God within us, that divine within us, to take us to that next place in consciousness. And I believe the third thing that I can learn from this is that just as Jesus went into Jerusalem that day, and perhaps that first Sunday, that Holy Week, perhaps he might have perceived it as a failure. But I believe it was a setback. How many of us in our life, how many of us, my dear friends, have thought, oh my goodness, this I have failed. This I have not created exactly the way I want to create it. I haven't co-created with spirit, with my thinking and my words and my actions. It's not exactly the way I want it. And so I'm a failure. And I say no. Sometimes what we perceive as a failure is nothing but a setback for a setup for us to achieve something greater in our life. It is a time when we perceive that we are a failure at times for us to call back our energies, to spend time in prayer, to know what to do next and allow Spirit to guide us. We don't have to give up. We don't have to give up. We just have to reassess the situation in our own life. Look at what happened to Jesus. What could have been perceived as a failure was truly a setup, not only for the crucifixion, but also a glorious resurrection. That, my friends, we can do. Charles Fillmore, co-founder of our Unity Movement, in a book called Keep a True Lent, Mr. Fillmore writes this. He says, Jerusalem, the holy city, symbolizes within us the habitation of peace, possession of peace, vision of peace, abode of prosperity within. My dear friends, we have a Jerusalem within us. And that is the peace that we seek. We seek peace, do we not, in our own life? We seek peace in this world. Thich Nhat Hanh writes this. He writes this. He says he's a Zen monk. In peace in every step, he writes. Although attempting to bring about world peace through the internal transformation of individual is difficult, it is the only way. World peace, it begins with me. That peace within, that holy city within me. My life and your life is a testimony to this world peace. I love you, I bless you, I behold the living presence of the divine within you. Happy Palm Sunday, and so it is. Amen.
Is a song by the by Anthony Brown and Group Therapy. Get ready.
This song's dedicated
to everyone.
To everyone who made it.
Yeah.
Through any test or trial,
in a hopeless situation,
hopeless situation. Now you have a story.
The angels can sing.
Angels can sing in glory.
We're redeemed.
You're redeemed from the hand of the enemy.
Yeah, here we go.
Whether it's in the courtroom,
at work,
fighting in the boardroom,
at home,
trying to feed your family,
in your heart, you know,
deep down underneath you.
That God is able.
God is more than able. God can turn the table.
So turn and tell.
Turn and tell your neighbor. Now it's time for you.
Yeah.
Turn the table.
Can I get a witness?
Can I get a witness?
Just need one more.
Just need one more witness.
That God's still working.
God's still working miracles.
Opening doors.
Opening doors that were closed before.
God's still making ways.
God's still making ways.
We're never saying that there ain't no way.
We're never saying that there ain't no way.
Been bound
by any illness,
laid up
in the sick room,
and the doctor said,
the doctor says there's nothing he can do.
We better call his family.
While they called your family,
so you cried out,
Lord, please help me,
because you knew
deep down inside that God could heal you.
Now let's fast forward. Hey,
and the doctors can't explain it.
Some way, somehow,
you made it.
You never stopped.
Stop believing.
Now you're walking.
Now you're walking in your healing.
Everything ain't perfect.
Everything's not perfect, but you don't look like what you've been through.
Now you can tell somebody.
Now you can tell somebody. If I did it for
yeah.
me,
yeah.
I can do it for you.
Can I get a witness?
Can I get a witness?
Just need one more.
Just need one more witness.
If God's still working.
God's still working miracles.
Opening doors.
Opening doors that were
closed.
God's
still making ways.
God's still making ways.
There ain't no way.
There ain't no way.
If you know this is true,
this is what I need you to do. Get up with me and say, can't nobody tell it like me.
Can't nobody.
I'm going to invite our ushers to come forth as we prepare to receive our tithes and our gifts and our offerings. And this morning, if you consider this your spiritual home or you've been spiritually fed in any way through the music, the meditation, the lesson, we invite you to make a gift to Unity Minneapolis. Those of you that are streaming with us today, we also invite you to make a gift to Unity Minneapolis on a secured website there. So let's just take a moment. If you're giving your gift with someone, hold it together. You have the power to bless it. We'll bless it together as well. I'll affirm our church offertory blessing once, and then ask you to affirm it with me, and then silently. Divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I give, all that I receive, and all that I am. Together, divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I give, all that I receive, and all that I am. And now silently. Thank you, God. Amen.
Last night as I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, the glad hosannas the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the moon was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow sing, Hosanna in once again the scene had changed. New earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of a God was on its streets. The gates were open wide, and all who would could enter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine.
Thank you, Judy. Thank you. So as our ushers come forth, let's just take a moment and we bless these tithes, these gifts, and these offerings. We bless the gifts that's been received in the mail. We bless those participating in our consistent giving program. We bless this community as we continue to fulfill our vision and mission of a transformed world. One life at a time. We send these gifts forth to do that. And we just say, thank you. Thank you, God. And so it is. And so we let it be. Amen. So how many of you brought that song, brought back many memories? Yeah, yeah. The church I grew up in, there were some that maybe was not so pleasant. But that was one of my favorite memories, and I want to thank Judy for my request one more year. And Lori, thank you very much. First of all, I just want to remind you that this week we have some wonderful services planned. On Thursday evening, Maundy Thursday, we'll look at the teachings of Jesus in the upper room, called the Upper Room Teachings. And they will also celebrate common union, communion with the elements on Thursday evening. Then we'll also have our prayer chaplains assisting us as we wash hands, as opposed to washing feet. We'll wash hands. And then we'll come together as a community in Friendship Hall with simple soup and simple bread. We invite you to bring that to share. And then on Friday, Good Friday service, over the top as well, with wonderful teachings about Jesus' seven last words and the metaphysical interpretation of that. And on Saturday, a wonderful Easter egg hunt. You don't want to miss it. We have live bunnies. Come and be a part of that, okay? And then on Sunday, of course, Easter Sunday. And you raise me up. You raise me up will be our lesson for next week as well. So come and be a part of that. As you know, we're right in the midst of a strategic plan. Patty Shevick, who is on that strategic plan ad hoc committee. We want to keep you informed. She has an announcement concerning that. And so we want you involved in our strategic plan. We can't do it without you.
That's true. Good morning, and Easter blessings to you. So over the course of the last several months, the Strategic Planning Committee has been diligently defining our roadmap for the future and preparing us to ask, what is God calling Unity Minneapolis to be? We start each meeting in keeping with our Unity principles by affirming our vision, our mission, and our core values, in addition to praying aloud a prayer for divine love, which we adapted from a Catherine Ponder's book, The Prospering Power of Love. Through this prayer, we have also adapted the affirmation, envisioning our future together in divine love. In support of our strategic planning initiative, it is our spirit of this divine love that we now invite you to participate by providing your input for the vision we want to hold for this spiritual community for the next 5 to 7 years. We are excited to announce that there is going to be 3 different options for you to get your voice heard. There's something for everyone. For the introverts, there's the one-on-one interviews, and those are going to start on April 25th. For the streamers, there's the online or written surveys, which also be starting on the 25th. And then the extroverts, of course, will be invited to come to focus groups. So the focus groups, there's a couple things that are already scheduled. On Saturday, April 29th, from 9 to noon, there's a continental breakfast involved, but we will be holding a focus group. The second option will be Thursday, May 4th, so that's an evening workshop, and that's from 6 to 9, and then light supper will be provided there. And also there'll be childcare provided at both as well. In the next few days, there'll be electronic communication coming out, so you can sign up that way too. We're also in need of some volunteers to help us, the Strategic Planning Committee, provide these services to you in ways, again, to get your voice heard. And especially the one that we really would like assistance is the one-on-one interviews. And we'll be doing training for that, so there's also a sign-up sheet for that in the garden court as well. So there'll be a representative out there. Please stop by and ask questions. I'm sure you'll have questions, but you'll be seeing more to come. And we really, really want you to participate. We value your opinion. We look forward to your participation. And as always, committee and the board, thank you for your continued prayers and support. Thank you and blessings.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. We do have multiple ways for you to participate, and you don't have to be an introvert to do the one-on-one interview. You can be an extrovert and vice versa, but we really have different ways for you to participate. I want to take just a moment before we bring our children in. And I truly want to appreciate our guests and our friends today, reminding you that we have Friendship Cake in Friendship Hall today. Okay, let's appreciate them. And let's stand together as we bring our children in, okay?
We are walking in the light, in the light, in the light. We are walking in the light. God. In the light, 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 in the light of God. You are walking in the light, in the light, in the light. You are walking in the light, in the light of God. In the light, in the light, in the light, in the light, in the light.
Good morning. We are excited about Easter. Can you feel it? Today we talked about Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem, and the kids got to go on a pilgrimage. And we had stops upstairs for a blessing, and of course they got a palm, and we learned a new song, Hosanna. And thanks for sharing your kids with us. I hope to see them back next Sunday as well for Easter. And then I can't let the day pass without letting you know that we did our packing on Wednesday night of hygiene kits. And John Sullivan and I had the privilege of dropping those off. And I cannot tell you. Yeah. What a difference all of you made together for many, many teens out there and others. They were overwhelmed with our generosity and the abundance that we pulled up in the Unity bus
for them. So thank you. Thank you.
Whoa. Speak to at least three people you don't know today before you leave the sanctuary. Let us know together our prayer for protection and our peace song. Together we know that the light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us wherever we are, and all is well.
Keep falling.